who might be joining us for the first time, my name is Father Brendan Guilfoyle. I'm one of the associate pastors here. And so as we prepare to learn about Christ and to learn who Christ is, let us begin, of course, by deepening our relationship with him in prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
From the Epistle to the Hebrews. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession. For we have not a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sinning. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in our time of need. Heavenly Father, we ask you to be with us. Open our minds and illumine our hearts, that we may come to know Christ your Son, and by coming to know him and to know who we are in his image, may we ever grow in our relationship with him. Through the same Christ our Lord.
Amen.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome back to our sixth installment out of eight. So we're almost 75% through the program. You're riding the bike downhill now. We rode up to the mountain, and now it's a downhill ride. So I'm proud of all of you so far. I mentioned so far. Tonight, we're going to shift gears a little bit and talk about a topic. So up to this point, we've been talking about specific thinkers or fathers of the church, specific individuals. And now we're going to talk about a fairly central controversy that preoccupied the church, frankly, from the beginning, but in this period that we're going to cover, it reaches a certain intensity that it hadn't before. And so it's commonly called Christology in the seminary. You're going to hear tonight the entire course you would get in the seminary, because this is a quick group, you know, and I know you can handle it. And so,
470 years.
Yes. So, I will paint the outlines of what is covered typically in the course, but you'll see what the dominant concerns were of the time and perhaps a way to frame all of that in your own minds. And again, I invite you to go further and study on your own on some of the reference materials that I'd called out in an earlier class. So we might get a little theological tonight. Last class we were more philosophical, so I thought, you know, we'll add a little more revelation to the philosophy. As we're going through this somewhat technical topic, I don't want to lose sight of what the participants were most concerned about. And it has to do with really a couple things. One, how does Jesus save us? And how does God save us? And specifically through Jesus. This is important because it links with what Jesus did for us reveals who he is. And if you think about it, the early apostles and the early Christians were not philosophers per se. They were not metaphysicians. So they saw what Jesus said and did and realized who he was. And so I don't want you to lose sight of that aspect of this. The other question that will be preoccupying us tonight is, how is Jesus two in one? How is Jesus God and man? How can we even think about that mystery? And keep in mind, it is a mystery of faith, ultimately, that we can't really ever exhaust or understand, but we can talk about it on some level. And that's what theology attempts to do, is attempts to put words to what our faith commitments are, so that we can knowingly love God as best we can. It's always good to love someone that you know. What characterizes this period, which is a little different than the first couple of centuries, is as we begin this and we get into the council like Nicaea, which occurred in 325, the church is experiencing a relative period of calm relative to being persecuted and running for your lives all the time. So that relative peace gave theologians and leaders a chance to kind of take stock of the theology and add more nuance and subtlety to it. So that's another dimension of this time frame, that the church was able to take a breath, if you will, and begin to reflect more seriously on what had been revealed. It also gave heretics, the weeds in the garden, a chance to grow as well. We're also going to see a clash of worldviews, and orthodoxy, as I will call it, is really clashing against two philosophical movements, two cosmologies, if you will, a heavily Platonist one, which is basically saying Jesus is not God, but he's a highly esteemed prophet or a highly demigod or eon in a Platonic sense, but he's not God. And the church is going to ultimately win out against that point of view. And the other point of view it's going to win out on is this suspicion of the body, this suspicion of the flesh. The flesh is dirty and ugly, unseemly, ungodly. And Jesus wasn't really human as a result. So we buy that he was divine and he was perfect. But all the ambiguous and mysterious references in the Gospels about Jesus for perhaps not knowing the end times, but the Father knows the end times. Or Jesus in Mark's Gospel wandering through the crowd and the woman with the hemorrhage touches his cloak and he says, "Who touched me?" People who thought Jesus was not God will run with those kinds of quotes. And folks that thought that Jesus was God but not human will emphasize other quotes in the Gospel about, especially in John, where Jesus has this tremendous confidence, even on the cross. If you just contrasted the words from the cross across the Gospels, and we touched on this last year, what were the words of the cross of Jesus in John's Gospel? "It is finished." Whereas we have the heartfelt cry in Mark and Matthew, my God, why have you forsaken me?" So what the Gospel writers are remembering are these words of Jesus from the cross in their full hue and their full complexity. But you note that if you're on one side of this debate or the other, you will run with those quotes to defend your position, the heretical extreme positions I was talking about. So orthodoxy will prevail, even though it was a minority position most of the time. The last thing, here's a little freebie for you. You'll see in the iconography, and you'll see it in this picture, this hand gesture. And hopefully I'll do it correctly. But you'll often see this hand gesture in art. You'll see popes sometimes bless the crowd this way. And what they're imaging, and the early church used these icons to teach, because no one could read, is God is three persons in one God, and in Jesus there are two natures in Jesus. And so this hand gesture, you see it in art, you'll see it in papal blessings to this day even, and that's what that hand gesture is about. So I thought I'd give a little background on that one so that you, when you see that in the future. Moving ahead then, I do want to emphasize that as we get theological, the death and resurrection of Jesus is really the corrective medicine to all of the theological speculation. The fact that Jesus Christ lived, died, and rose will always be that tonic, if you will, that braces the church to find the proper course. And I'll come back to that again and again. And we see it in many of the fathers of the church. We see it in some of the texts of the New Testament. But this quote from St. Gregory Nazianzus, whatever is not assumed is not redeemed. He's emphasizing the fact that if Jesus doesn't become human, there's no bridge back to God. It's not redeemed. So whatever is not assumed, humanity, is not redeemed. And another way he puts that, and other writers put that, is like is saved by like. If you want to have a key open a door, in some way the key has to have been designed from the lock in the door. Like opens like. Like saves like. So there's this hand-in-glove aspect to our salvation that propels orthodoxy. So Jesus has to be human if he's going to save humanity. The other side of this is St. Athanasius, who was a great father of the church who fought Arianism, and we'll see what that means in a bit, in the 4th century. He was thrown out of his diocese five times. He was the bishop of Alexandria and was tossed out five times, would be hiding in the mountains. The politics would change. He would have a favorable reception back to his diocese. Then the politics would change again. The Arians would get back into power, and he would have to flee again. And he was a true defender of the Orthodox path, really, out of Nicaea and all the way to other councils. But he's famous for a quote that, "For he was made man that we might be made God," which is the flip side of our salvation, is that in order for us to be saved due to an offense of our original parents, which separated us from God and had infinite consequences, that can only be bridged by God. So we have this dynamic set up that a true mediator is someone who can stand in for both sides. C.S. Lewis, in his work Mere Christianity, talks about God standing with one foot on the bank and one foot in the river, and we're in the river, and we're about to go down and over the waterfall. And he's reaching into that and grabbing and pulling us out. And he can do that because he's in the river, he's human, and he's got one foot on the bank, which is a symbol of divinity. And so this bridging function that Jesus shows and executes from in his being, if you will, is the linchpin of our salvation. And so these two fathers, St. Gregory and St. Athanasius, are speaking to the two points of that bridge, if you will. So when we get into the theological aspects and the terminology, keep in mind that it is about this mediator, Jesus Christ, and getting that right. Because if we don't get the theology right, our worship and our prayer will become deformed and weird and strange. And that's really the role of Orthodox theology, is to promote clear thinking so that we can love clearly. If we had odd views of Jesus, we might not behave and act a certain way. We might not believe in the real presence of the Eucharist, for example. We might just believe that it's holy bread. But if Jesus is God, then we know it's more than that. It's the body, blood, soul, divinity of Jesus Christ. So there are lots of spiritual and practical implications to getting this theology correct. That's how our salvation is achieved. So on the next page, again, it's terribly unfair that I do this, and my former teachers at the seminary in Bible would be tearing their hair out, the ones that have hair. How can you summarize the Christology of the four gospel writers on one PowerPoint slide? Well, as you know, for those of you who are in business, you're trained to do this, to boil things down, and hopefully I haven't misrepresented it. But if we look briefly at Mark, and this question came up, I think, in our first class, Jesus is the Messiah and Son of God in Mark, in an interesting way that Mark tells the story. If you recall in Mark's gospel, the first half of the gospel is really about what's called the messianic secret, is what the scholars will talk about. Jesus is performing miracles and then telling the beneficiary of that miracle, "Don't tell anyone who I am." When he heals the paralytic, what was scandalous is that he forgave his sins. And the observers, the Jewish Pharisees, said, only God can forgive sins. That's what was scandalous. It was later scandalous to heal on the Sabbath, but people had been healed before. What was really scandalous is that Jesus was claiming to do something only God can do, namely forgive sins. So the way Jesus approached this is, I will perform miracles to get their attention, and then reveal later in the second half of the gospel who I really am and what my mission really is, namely to be the Messiah, the Son of God. So the miracles are a sign of his power to do God-like things. And the real God-like thing is to save us from our sins. If we go to Matthew, Matthew is thought to have been writing for a Jewish audience. And so it's very important to Matthew to ground the reality of Jesus in the history of Israel, as well as, so we have the genealogy in Matthew, as well as the fulfillment of Old Testament prophecy. We also have the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew, which in a way functions as the final completion of the Ten Commandments. So Jesus as lawgiver on the Mount in a similar way that Moses was lawgiver of the Ten Commandments. What's interesting about the Sermon on the Mount is it's the call to the sacrificial love, which was hard for people to understand at the time, and it's hard for us to understand at the time. How do the meek inherit the earth, for example? If we move on from that, we have in Matthew what I call, and others call, the eschatological judge. Namely, we have the sheep's and the goat type stories. We have that there will be a judgment at the end of time, and that the wheat will be harvested and the weeds will be thrown and burned. So we have an eschatological theme that's developed in Matthew as well. If we move on to Luke, and obviously there's a lot more in these Gospels, but if we move on to Luke, you recall in a prior class, most people believe that Luke is the first volume of the two-volume Luke-Acts. Luke's Acts of the Apostles. And here we have the beautiful infancy narratives of Jesus in Luke. We have this grounding of the life of Jesus, also in the history of Israel. We have, even in Acts, Stephen's famous speech narrating the history of Israel, and you killed all the prophets, you never believed them, and that got them really angry, and they eventually stoned Stephen. And you have this opening to the Gentiles. You have in Luke, Jesus marveling at the faith of a Gentile. You remember who that was? The centurion. The only time in any of the Gospels Jesus marvels at the faith of someone is a Gentile. That would have been noticeable to an early Jewish audience in the first century. So that was, you remember that story, his servant is ill, and he says, just give a command. You don't have to come to my house. Just give a command and my servant will be better. And he relates that to his own experience of having men under him to command. And Jesus was astounded by that act of faith because it had such respect for authority. That is front and center in Luke, this mission to the Gentiles as it evolves. John we have talked about as well here and there. Thought to have been written a bit later than the three other Gospels. But here we have a real emphasis on the Jesus who is self-possessed, full knowledge of who he is, what he is about. And we have this pre-existence narrative going on in John at the beginning of the Gospel, and frankly throughout the Gospel. We have what I call here the I am statements, which are, remember when Jesus says, I am the resurrection, the life, I am the bread that comes down from heaven. The early audiences would have noticed that if they were Jewish, they would refer that to Yahweh. I am who am, when he said that to Moses. When Moses said, look, if you want me to go back to the people, there are many gods out there, what should I call you? And God responds by saying, I am who am. There are no other gods before me, I am who am. Jesus in John's Gospel will pick up that language and recall Jesus saying something to that effect, and I am the resurrection and the life. So we have this bridging function in John, not only back to the Old Testament, but picking up the pre-existence theme as well, the divinity of Jesus from the beginning. So that's the New Testament Christology in a nutshell. There's obviously much more. But I wanted to kind of set up the deck, so to speak, on we have all these different themes going on in the four Gospels. And it's not quite accurate to say that, well, only John really talked about Jesus as Son of God or divine. The other Gospel writers do it, but they do it differently. They do it through stories. They do it thematically. Whereas John is really hitting us over the head with it in the way Jesus expresses himself and how he even thinks about himself. A question here.
The pronunciation of the Trinity, the Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit.
You know.
Yes.
Is important.
Paul, thank you. Thank you for calling that out. In all the Gospels, but in particularly in John, thank you. We have the sending of the Paraclete. And if you think of how all the Gospels work together with the baptismal formulas you see in the other Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. John is also developing that more, that Jesus is sending the Paraclete, the Holy Spirit, after himself to guide the church and to guide the Christians. So there's this other the inner life of God is being revealed in John in some way. This sending of the Holy Spirit, which is referred to in all the Gospels, but certainly has an interesting name in John, the Paraclete, one who is sent. Now we have to get a little theological, and I want to challenge you a little bit. And keep in mind that this material can be drawn from many places, but I was looking the other day through a college freshman textbook from the 1950s, and this material is in it. So it's interesting how sophisticated in some way Catholic education was in those days. Talking about everything, in fact, I'm covering tonight was covered in this college freshman textbook. It's covered in other places, obviously, too, but that's what's interesting. So I would like to cover at least these three core terms with you. And they do come from philosophy, but they have a natural congeniality with theology, because theology picks up the grammar, if you will, the vocabulary of what is the contemporary terms that are being used in the area of philosophy and theology. And the first one is nature. And nature, really, the way I like to present this, and I took this from the Baltimore Catechism for fifth graders, if you remember. Some of you remember the Baltimore Catechism. Yes. Nature answers the question, what is it? And if you remember the little graph in the Baltimore Catechism, there's a picture of a finger pointing at a nature of a dog or a man or something like that. So nature, human nature, or the nature of a dog or a nature of a plant, answers the question, what is it? What is its identity? What is its essence? Other words that'll be used are substance. In physics, it's called physis, which means nature. It's where our word physics comes from. It's also where our word, part of it comes from light, photon, phus. And so some philosophers thought nature is what lights up when we see it and experience it. We're going to see the beginning of a clash of terminology between the Latin-speaking West and the Greek-speaking East. And Latin, natura, which literally comes from a verb to be born, is also translated into substantia and essentia. That's how a Latin speaker would understand nature. So this will, I'm setting the table for what's coming. So nature answers the question, what is it? In the technical jargon, it's the that by which something is what it is. That by which something is what it is. So far, so good? So dogs have dogs' natures, as my moral theologian, Professor Pat Boyle, used to say when teaching us natural law, golf balls do golf ball things. And in Pat's case, they usually bounced on the cart path. But golf balls do golf ball things. They bounce. They're kind of hard. If you hit them incorrectly, they'll slice. And what he's trying to say is things act according to their nature. And that's what nature is. Person answers the question, who is it? Who is the subject of responsibility? It is that which is something, that which has a nature. It's the ultimate I, if you will. And in Greek, this word is called, in English it's transliterated hypostatic, and maybe you've heard that term hypostatic union before. That means person union. And hypostasis is the Greek pronunciation. And if you think about prefixes, hypo means under. Hypodermic, needle, goes under the skin, under the dermis. So a person in the Greek understanding, which did precede the Latin understanding, is something that stands under, a stand-underer. And I know that sounds terrible, but it's what stands under. And it's easily confused, as you can see, with the Latin word substantia, which also means stand under. So a subway is a train that's under the way. You know, a submarine is under the water. A substance is what stands under as well. So you can already see there's some confusion in the terminology that's creeping in. between Latin speakers and Greek speakers about what do we mean by person. What we mean in English is a person is the ultimate I. It is that which has a nature, that which exists. So far, so good, I hope. Last vocabulary term I wanted to introduce is the notion of being. Being answers the question, is it? Does it have existence? And it's, as I put here, it's the that by which something is what it is. So think about it. Human nature doesn't have within it the definition that it should exist. We can all think of people who had human natures that don't exist on Earth anymore, or we can think of things that don't exist in any sense. So Napoleon might be alive in the afterlife in heaven, but he's dead now. But we could think of other things that have natures that are dead and don't have being as part of their definition. Right? They're not necessary. You exist, but it's not necessary that you exist. There's not a one-to-one equation that you exist, right? So your nature is something different than your being. So far, I hope you're tracking with me. And in Greek, this is ousia. In Latin, it's esse. And when we get to a particular controversy, we'll see how this plays out. But these three terms, nature, person, being, you have to have some appreciation for to appreciate what is all the controversy about. Any questions on the terminology? To be provocative, is there a being that exists by nature?
God.
Who?
God.
God. Isn't that interesting? God's nature is to be. Now, this is philosophical, somewhat, but every other nature that's created is not necessary, or every other nature that exists doesn't have to exist. God's nature is to exist. So there we have an identification of being in nature. But in every other created reality, it's not necessary. Person is an I, the ultimate subject of responsibility, if you want to think of it that way. Any other comments before we continue? Okay. So now let's get to this is a little bit like your mall map. When you enter a large mall, you are here. Hopefully this orients you. And I want to kind of go around the wheel, and this could be helpful, useful to how you think about what follows. So we know in Jesus, the Orthodox position, the Catholic position, is one divine person, the second person of the Trinity, and a divine nature and a human nature. That's ultimately the Orthodox position that will win out in the Council of Chalcedon in 451 AD. For a long time, that was the minority point of view. So there's a cautionary tale on what's right, what's true, is often for a long time the minority point of view. As G.K. Chesterton once said, we don't want a church that's right when the world's right. We want a church that's right when the world's wrong. And counting noses to get to the truth is not how things actually operate in practice. Now, that can carry the day for a while, but that's not how the Orthodox position was ultimately forged. So as we go around the wheel, we'll have all varieties of errors. Something's called Nestorianism, that believe that in a mysterious way, the integrity of the two natures had to be protected, so there was two persons and two natures in Jesus Christ. And how they kind of coexisted together was never fully explained. Some scholars think Nestorian got a bad rap, that he really didn't hold this. That's a relatively new view. The vast body of literature on Nestorian is that he did hold a weird dualism in Jesus Christ of two perfected persons and two natures, divine and human. So that's at the 12 o'clock position. As we go to the 3 o'clock position, we have some of the early heresies that will later flower into Arianism, which you'll meet in a moment, where Jesus is human but not fully divine. And so with Arianism, there's this lack of comfort with Jesus being divine, that God is one, God is singular. So let me say that again. God is not present in Jesus. Jesus is human, aspiring to be God, but not God. Perhaps the highest created thing that God created, but he's not God. That's the Arian position. And that's this side of the conflict of the early Christians not being comfortable with thinking that Jesus is God. Does that create two gods? Does that create a polytheism? So that's at that 3 o'clock position. At the 6 o'clock position is the Monophysites. And they kind of confuse the issue by shaking the divine and human elements together, kind of like a martini. And they were often not clear on how do we adjudicate how Jesus is God and man and come out with a mono, one nature, one person, perhaps neither God, neither man, or one element will dominate the other. And so that's called a Monophysite. The Monophysites actually hung on for quite a long time in the Middle East, as did the Nestorians. So that's at that 6 o'clock position. Now when we swing over to the 9 o'clock position, that's what we get to where Jesus is viewed as divine and not human. This is where the crowd were uncomfortable with Jesus being human because of the reasons I was mentioning to you about the flesh being awkward, the flesh being seen as something fallen, not lovable. A good God wouldn't create the flesh. The problem of evil is wrapped up in the flesh. So Jesus was not human. He was God, but he was play-acting being human. He pretended to be human. He really didn't suffer. So those are the terms of this debate, if you will. And the Orthodox position is right smack dab in the middle of this, that Jesus is a divine person with a divine nature and a human nature. So any questions on this wheel? Yes. On your first part of your question, Nestorianism is hard to understand, but it's basically trying to be faithful to the claims that came out of a later council called Constantinople, that Jesus is God and he is man. So how do I explain the union? And he didn't say it was a hypostatic union. So there was this loose association, like they're standing next to each other, which is in one of your slides, and it was never explained how they actually work together so that we don't have a schizophrenic Jesus. There's one eye there, ultimately, and the Nestorian never explained how this union occurred. Some commentators will say, well, he claimed it was kind of a moral union or a spiritual union. They commune spiritually together. But that's not good enough. That's wet tissue paper to explain the self-possession Jesus had, the confidence Jesus had, all of the statements of Jesus in the New Testament, as well as the experience of Jesus from the apostles and their successors. So Nestorianism was ultimately condemned because it doesn't explain anything. Okay. Anything else before we continue? Okay. The next chart I won't read to you. It's really there more for your reference, and we can refer back to it as we go. But it's a way of cataloging, if you will, these heresies, their timing, what the church response was to them and how it was responded to, and use this as a reference, but it's in chronological order, generally speaking. But you can see how all of these heresies participate in one of two ways. Either we're uncomfortable with Jesus being God because God is one. And to think that Jesus is God implies maybe a polytheism. And then the other side of it is we're uncomfortable with Jesus being human. And in some ways that crept into the spirituality and Christology of the church, you know, in the 19th century and midway through the 20th century. The fact that Jesus might have perspired or was hungry didn't necessarily fit the piety of the time. It's not heretical what was going on at that time, of course. It was completely orthodox, but the piety tended to exalt Jesus to the point, well, is he really human? There was this exalted Jesus. And in the first centuries, there was also this lack of comfort with Jesus being human because of the philosophies that were going through their heads at the time, the body being fallen. Remember the Platonic philosophy we went through, and even Origen thought we all started as angels and fell to be human beings with a body, and we're trapped in a body until the soul is free to ascend back to the one. So you can see how in that kind of culture and sense of things that there'd be a lack of comfort with Jesus being fully human, which we know from St. Paul that he was, save for sin. So this is a chart. Now, what I'd like to do is take us down a little path, and I have animated. So if you look at the two poles of this, on the left here, you have, and this is a gross generalization, but I hope it helps you. You have the Western view, the emphasis on Jesus' humanity. And it's, you might call it the, for those who know this, the Antioch school, where it's starting with the facts on the ground. And the facts on the ground are, we've got Jesus as a human being and divine. So how do we go from 2 to 1? How do we go from this godlike person and this human person back to a unity? So they're starting 2 to 1. You remember in our first class when I talked about the Palestinian Christianity that started at the end. Jesus' death and resurrection, and he's coming soon. Second coming is coming soon. The flavor of this by the second, third, fourth century is facts on the ground is Jesus was human and divine. How do we get this back together? On the right side, I'll call this the Alexandrian school, the Eastern school of the original unity to God. How do we go from 1 to 2? How do we go from God as one to God in Jesus as divine and human? So it's a slightly different path to orthodoxy. How do I go from 1 to 2 in the Alexandrian school, as you look at this on the right, with the emphasis on divinity? How do we get to humanity correctly? And the school on the left, how do we go from humanity to divinity and up? So keep that in mind as we progress. And I hope you find this visually useful. So adoptionism starts with the fact that Jesus is human and was eventually adopted by God. Maybe he made it to be divine. Perhaps at his baptism in the Jordan is when God adopted him, because we had the message, this is my beloved son. So maybe it was at that point, because that's scriptural, that Jesus was adopted by God, and it's called adoptionism. And it's a way of not acknowledging Jesus' full divinity. And it was an early heresy the church had to deal with. Docetism. So now we're on the right side. Jesus is God. It's unseemly and weird that he would be human, because to be human is to be fallen. And to be fallen is ungodlike. And Jesus could not mix with what's human. So you see this error of docetism creeping in from the beginning as well. Arianism, Arius is the name of the heretic, comes out of this divinity light, if you will, school, that Jesus is not really divine. And as it says here, they denied the full divinity of Jesus. Jesus is certainly the highest created thing that God ever made, but he is not God, and he is not divine in the sense that God is divine. That's called Arianism, after its author, Arius. Right, Arius. So the correction came at the Council of Nicaea, and we recite the Nicene Creed at Mass when priests are up for the long form. As soon as they introduced the word consubstantial, priests went for the Apostles' Creed almost immediately. At the parishes I go to, they said, ah, no, I can't pronounce consubstantial. So what happened at Nicaea? They condemned Arianism. They condemned Arius. And they used a term that I would like to write out. Here I am. Marker, okay. They used a Greek term, and my handwriting's awful, by the way. Homoousion. I mean, it's one word, but homo means the same being. So homo, we see it in other words like homosexual, same-sex attraction. Homoousion means same being as God. Homoousion, with God. In Latin, the old way it was translated was one in being with the Father. And then out of a sense of purity, when the prayer was revised a couple years ago now, quite a while ago now, it was consubstantial with the Father. So, but Arius and the Neo-Arians, which we'll touch on briefly, said, oh yeah, we believe that, but we use this term. Homoi. Usian, like, similar to, but not same. So Arius was able to shuck and jive, if you will, with the authorities for quite a while by just saying, homoousion is what we believe. It sounds very similar, and it's written very similarly, but it means something very different. That Jesus is similar in being, kind of, sort of, like, by analogy, divine, but not divine. So Nicaea insisted on this term. And it's really the first time. This council of Nicaea is considered really the first ecumenical council. There were other regional councils. We had the Council of Jerusalem and Acts of the Apostles. Maybe that could be considered an ecumenical council on some level. But if you count up the ecumenical councils, Nicaea is primary. And it's the first time a council, which is an exercise of the sacred tradition of the church, formally defines something using a term from Greek philosophy. You won't find this term out of the mouths of Peter or Paul or the other gospel writers. So it's an example of the Holy Spirit with the church using terminology from philosophy to clarify a mystery of faith. Because there are lots of versions of it in circulation. So that's the first stake in the ground, the Council of Nicaea in 325 AD. And the council was able to at least settle some disputes, but it didn't end the disputes. So if we advance a little bit further, the Neo-Arians, and hopefully you all caught that animation, came out of that because they were still saying, well, yeah, we're faithful to Nicaea. We're saying homoousion. And that took away. This is where Athanasius got tossed out of his diocese again, because the Neo-Arians were able to convince future emperors after Constantine that, oh, we're Orthodox. This guy is a troublemaker. And he was tossed out of his diocese. On the other side, you have what's called Apollarianism. And here, they said yes. So they were trying to be faithful to the spirit of Nicaea, and said, yes, Jesus is same being as the Father, and that being of Jesus, that divine part of Jesus, is the rational part of Jesus' humanity. It's the part that finishes that humanity, because Jesus, the divine Jesus, that I, that mind, that will, in some ways replace the human mind and will. And so they had this, what's called logos, this extreme logos Christology that we talked about before. The Word of God takes over humanity and in some way disintegrates it to make room for its cognitive divinity, its intellectual divinity. And that's a heresy on the other extreme, because the full humanity of Jesus is being compromised. It's being stunted, if you will. If we continue, watch for the animation. Okay. So the Council of Constantinople in 381 is attempting to address once and for all Neo-Arianism. They won't give up on this, of Jesus being like God but not God. That finally is going to quit at this point. But they're also condemning Jesus' divinity overwhelming the humanity to the point that it's not human. Whatever that human nature is, it's been compromised completely. Its intellectual faculties have been replaced by the divine faculties, if you will. And you can see how that's a diminishment of what it means to be human. You see what's going on here. We have controversy, resolution, spawns more controversy, resolution, and the people are running with what they think is the orthodox position and manhandling it, twisting it to another heretical direction. And the light here might obscure this a little bit, but here you have, coming out of Constantinople, Jesus is fully divine, fully human. And you can see on the earlier question about Nestorian, he thought he was being orthodox. Okay, if he's fully divine and fully human, to be fully human, he's a human person. You'll even hear that in preaching, that Jesus is a human person. Did you know he's not a human person? He's a divine person who took a human nature. That always gets people. But you will hear preaching, not necessarily Catholic preaching, but other preaching, talk about Jesus being a human person. But as we saw from our earlier definitions, a person is that which is the ultimate subject of responsibility, the ultimate I. So that's what the Nestorians on this left side of the page are struggling with and dealing with. On the right side, you have this continuation of the logos. Sarx means flesh in Greek. And you have this continued pondering of how do we maintain the humanity of Jesus, because we know the logos, the Word of God, has assumed that humanity. How do we still think about his humanity? And it was still inadequate in terms of how they talked about it. And if you see the next step of the animation, Cyril of Alexandria was a proponent of this logos sarx, this word flesh theology. And he eventually arrived at a modification of this, which brought him closer to orthodoxy. But he was one of the key combatants against Nestorian. And Nestorian emphasized the true integrity of both natures. He was trying to be consistent. And because there's always a question about Nestorian theology, which is heretical. And you have the divine Jesus on the left saying, "Nice to meet you, Jesus, my name is Christ." And on the right, Jesus is saying, "I suppose we'll be working together for a while." This is a hopefully a humorous picture of a Nestorian approach to who is Jesus, how does he work. I thought at this point you needed some humor, a little palate cleanser. Any questions so far? The distinction I'm trying to make about person and nature is that Jesus Christ, the second person of the Trinity, took on a human nature that was complete in its humanity. Then you have the poetic expression of St. Paul saying that Christ was like us in all things, save sin. So those two completely harmonize with each other. One's a poetical expression, one's a technical, theological expression. Okay, so just continuing our journey, Ephesus ultimately condemns the Nestorian view. You just saw the picture of Nestorius with this loose, hard-to-understand connection between the two, between the divine and the human parts of Jesus. How do we think about them? How do we connect them? So the Council of Ephesus, another ecumenical council in 431, will condemn Nestorian. And there is this schism, though, that remains between Antioch and Alexandria. Then continuing, you have what's called the Monophysites, which is what's called an extreme version of St. Cyril, that there is really just one nature. Remember, phusis meant nature. There's one thing in Jesus. There's one nature remaining. There's the divine part wins. And that the humanity of Jesus is really rendered impotent, if you will, or it's overwhelmed by the divinity of Jesus. So there's really one nature, shaken on some level, but there is no separation ultimately in practice for this group. You finally have the Council of Chalcedon in 451 put a definitive end to this madness by defining this union between the divine and the human as a hypostatic union. What is the nature of that union, if I can use that expression? That it's hypostatic, that it is rooted in the person of the second person of the Trinity. These two natures in here, cohere in the second person of the Trinity. And I'll read you that formula in a moment. The rest of this just gives you themes for each point of this cataloging, and then if you go to the end, you'll see the names of the participants. And this is for your reference, if you want to do further reading on any one of these types of folks. The Pope St. Leo did intervene through a letter to the Council of Chalcedon, and you can read the canons of any of the ecumenical councils online or in books. And at the Council of Chalcedon, the church fathers of that time, East and West, acknowledge the letter, it's called the Tome of St. Leo, as Peter speaking. So you have another recognition, if you will, of the Bishop of Rome intervening in an ecumenical way across East and West to clarify and give credence to the Orthodox position of the Council, which they took. So I just mentioned that in passing. And then let me read to you the formula of Chalcedon. This is, I think, one of the things that the seminarians have to know when they end the Christology course. Is that correct, fathers? This is something they have to recite with like running in place, like the military, like a fraternity hazing of some kind. But let me read this to you. This is from 451 AD, the Council of Chalcedon. Following the Holy Fathers, we teach with one voice that the Son of God and our Lord Jesus Christ is to be confessed as one and the same person. They use that Greek word for person, that he is perfect in Godhead and perfect in manhood. Very God and very man, of a reasonable soul and human body, consubstantial with the Father as touching his Godhead, and consubstantial with us as touching his manhood, made in all things like us, sin only excepted, begotten of his Father before the worlds according to his Godhead, but in these last days for us men and for our salvation, born into the world of the Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, according to his manhood. So you see the perfect balance that's being achieved there. You have a description of perfect God, perfect in terms of his humanity, but united in the person of God, in the second person, the Trinity. This one and the same Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, must be confessed to be in two natures, unconfusedly, So they are distinct. They're not shaken together like the Monophysites were claiming. Immutably. So adoptionism, out the window. Jesus didn't kind of evolve into being divine. Indivisibly, inseparably united. So they are united in a real and true sense. And that without the distinction of natures being taken away by such union, so neither nature is compromised by this union, but rather the peculiar property of each nature being preserved and being united in one person and subsistence, not separated or divided into two persons, but one and the same Son and only begotten, God the Word, our Lord Jesus Christ, as the prophets of old time have spoken concerning him, and as the Lord Jesus Christ has taught us, and as the Creed of the Fathers has delivered to us. So there's a lot in that. But you can see they're trying to resolve all of the conflicts that were known at that point that they were comfortable resolving in this formula. And this is what is the Orthodox faith of the Church. Now, I'd love to say that that ended all the problems. It did not. Some of the bishops that went to their homelands returning from this council had to run for their lives. The local people were upset at them. Some local tribes were upset with them for claiming that Jesus was God. And in some of those lands, 150 years later, the Islamic faith would take root because the conflicts couldn't be resolved. And so the Church had a very thin wall of defense in certain areas in the Middle East because these controversies would not die. And those people in those areas were sympathetic to the monotheistic view of Christianity that excluded the divinity of Christ. So you can see in some way how the ground was being prepared, apart from other political forces and military issues, for the Islamic faith. There are other things we could talk about from other areas, but this resolved it from a Catholic Orthodox point of view. But it didn't necessarily resolve it on the ground when those bishops went home. The controversies continued in different ways and shapes and forms, but no one would ever doubt what the Orthodox point of view was if they were sincere. Up to this point, you had the combatants going at it back and forth. So at this point, people are usually looking for a lifeline, oxygen, a cool drink. And so I would like to pivot, because oftentimes people will, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, Charles, thank you for that journey. We followed you, but if we knew the path back, we would have taken it 30 minutes ago. But the truth is, these controversies have in fact never stopped. And it's useful and helpful to you to know the background. And there's a lot of theological precision that is there if you would like to go further into it, but let's talk about how these things show up today. And these are a couple ones that are obvious to me, and maybe there are others that are obvious to you as well. But the first one is what someone mentioned earlier, which is, yes, there's a hand in the back. And that's a very good question. How does God take on a human nature? How does God enter time? Right? So that's kind of the flavor of the question is, how does God, who is perfect, infinite, out of time, enter into time and humanity, taking on a human nature? You could do variations on that question. How does God respond to a prayer I say tomorrow? How does God influence history? Or classically, how does God create anything at all? But in the context of this question, it's how does God take on a human nature? How does God enter time? And ultimately, this is a mystery of faith. So I don't want to kid you. But theologians talk about how does eternity touch time? And they can break it into a couple of ways. And if these are helpful, great. If they confuse you, just pretend I didn't say them. Philosophers and theologians will talk about relationships, relations. So for example, a son has a relationship to a father. That's called a mutual relationship. A father is only a father if he has a son. A son is only a son if he has a father. So those two require each other, and that relationship in the scholastic philosophy is called a mutual relationship because you rely on both. There's something called immutual relationships. An immutual relationship, the example would be the reflection of a tree on the bank of a pond, in the pond. So the tree's reflection is in the pond. Was there any change in the tree? But there's real change in the pond. That's an immutual relationship because there is something going on that implied no change in the tree, but it certainly perfected the pond. Namely, it bears now the image of a tree. Another example that philosophers will use is me knowing a novel or an idea, or let's keep it to a book. So I read Crime and Punishment. There's a new perfection in me, namely knowledge of Raskolnikov. I have a new concept, if you will. Did the book change?
No.
No. That's another example of an immutual relationship because one term didn't change, but I did when I knew the book, when I read the book. So these are often used as imperfect ways of describing how God relates to anything created. But in a special way, he took on a human nature, and it's described in this way. Now this sounds very dry and clinical, because how do I pray to that? If God doesn't change, how do I feel like there's a personal God? And this is where the theology has to stop and prayer on your knees takes over, which John Paul was very fond of saying as well. There comes a point where theology has to be silent because the experience of faith is deeper and richer than our ability to even articulate it to ourselves. But for the sake of praying to the true God, we need theology so that we don't stray and fall into some of these problems that we'll get to. Was that helpful or did I confuse? Okay. Yes, John.
So basically at this point, the East and the West were united, correct?
What,
like Antioch and Alexandria, when they came together at this council?
You know, it's a loose consensus. There's a consensus among the council fathers.
Right.
And then they go home and some of them get beat up. And like a lot of things, you have a meeting. Who took notes again? You know, what did we agree to exactly? Think of 451 AD. They didn't have the copying machine. They couldn't send you home with your spiral-bound decrees of the council. So there was consensus.
But the bishops of Antioch, the bishops of Alexandria, they did.
There was some agreement, but then as time goes on, the agreement loosens, if not immediately.
Because at what point then was the Eastern Church did not recognize the Pope of Rome?
So that's a different question, but that happens a little bit later.
Okay.
But you can see the seeds being planted now. They don't speak the same language. The liturgies are becoming very different. The dates they celebrate Easter are different. So you can't just be careful of pinning it on the event we're talking about. Lots of things are at work.
But there was some commonality, some unity.
Yes, yes.
At this point.
Yes. But it's a loose unity.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes. But suffice it to say that our spiritual experience of God, who is a personal God, is much more the case than our ability to articulate about that spiritual experience. Keep in mind what theology is trying to do is to create, think of it as creating goal lines on the football field for how the game needs to be played. But you wouldn't reduce the game to the out of bounds line. The play is in the field. The play is in our spiritual life. The boundaries is the theology, but you wouldn't reduce your faith to the boundaries. You want to live your faith. That's what that's what theology is trying to protect, is your spiritual experience. So, because our prayers today have real effect on the souls in purgatory, offering masses for the souls in purgatory has real effect. And so the real question is, how does a soul in purgatory experience this? Oh, all of a sudden the heat went down. A couple more questions, then we'll go to, yes, Bill.
Well, this goes to really the concept of nature and man and mm-hmm. divinity and Christ. And right. for Christ to be both having the nature of man and divinity, does that mean that the nature of man is both human and divine to be together? In other words, because we're human,
right.
that means we're not divine.
Right.
So how, you know, what you are is defined part about what you're not. You're not a dog, for example.
Right.
So to bring them together, somehow, it must be in man's nature to be with the divine in some sense.
That's an interesting question. And the question is in some mysterious way, is the human nature able to be placed within the divine in some sense? The human nature is available to be divinized. Maybe that's another way to put it. And that's a very interesting question. And the short answer is yes. And thank goodness, is that we have, and this, again, we'll get a little technical and I apologize, but this would fall under the heading of nature and grace. You might remember the expression, grace builds on nature. And there's a congeniality between nature and grace. And theologians, especially in the 20th century, picked this theme up in a significant way that, in fact, our human nature has a certain aptitude in it for grace, to be elevated to the level of grace. And in fact, in some theologies, it's constitutive of being human, this ability to react to the promptings of grace in a way that a frog cannot. That's uniquely human. And that's therein lies our Christian humanism, the philosophies and theologies of John Paul II, that our humanity images and is available to be elevated in a spiritual divine way.
Well, you have to watch out.
So the comment was Teilhard de Chardin, a crazy Jesuit who was popular.
No,
is that redundant? But if you went into the rectories of priests from the 60s and 70s and 80s, you'd see on their bookshelf the phenomenon of man, and that this was a natural evolution, capital N, among other things, to a graced existence. So there are extreme varieties and abuses of what was just said. So how does this show up? Let me get to you at the end. How does this show up today? So Christianity is one of many options. So if Jesus is not divine, we can appeal to many different figures who have appeared on the stage of history. Jesus is not the exclusive mediator between God and man. All graces do not flow, if we even believe in the term grace, do not flow through Jesus and the Catholic Church, by the way. Being true to oneself is where the divine is found, which is modern-day Gnosticism. I mentioned a book last week that is probably the most popular book that's been sold in the last 5 years. If you look at the Amazon.com meter, Eat, Pray, Love, which is nothing but a Gnostic text on the divine is you. And there's a sense in which that's true. We would say that, yes, I am made in the image and likeness of God. And I experience God in my life, in my soul. And that's all very fine and orthodox and no problem. It's very different to then say, I am God. So we have that rolling around today. We have in preaching, both Catholic and Christian, that Jesus didn't know he was God or realize that. And this is the adoptionist heresy in New 21st and 20th century clothing. God is only present in Jesus as he realized it. So the being of God is dependent on some psychocognitive recognition of it. And we have this today in preaching that Jesus was kind of fumbling with who he was as Messiah, who am I? You have the explanation of miracles this way, namely that they really didn't happen, that Jesus multiplied the loaves and fishes by inspiring the people to share the food they had brought with them. That was very popular. You don't hear that one so much. But the emphasis is on self-consciousness and self-awareness. And if you think about it, if you relied on you being conscious of grace in your life, for there to be grace in your life, that's a very dangerous thing to hold. How would we baptize babies? Are they conscious of the grace of baptism? So that one is problematic, and it shows up today, but it was a form of adoptionism. This next one is controversial, which is why I put it up here. I wanted to be a little spiky with this. But there are those who think that Jesus didn't intend to found the Catholic Church. Its mission or its essential hierarchical structure. Did Jesus intend Monsignors? You probably don't have to hold that. Did he intend Cardinals? You probably don't have to hold that. Did he intend an apostolic tradition with a hierarchy? You do have to hold that. Did he intend to found and institute the Catholic Church? Yes, you do have to hold that. So these things pop up today as opinions that, no, the church was really founded by people inspired by Jesus, but he did not, Jesus did not intend them to really launch this institution. It's man-made, it's corrupt, it's about power, etc., and it's been overwhelmed by those vices, so end of story. So that's another speaking to the knowledge of Jesus. All of this, as I put at the bottom, labors under a false theology. Namely, that the second person of the Trinity is the ultimate I in Jesus Christ. It is the one acting. He is the one with his foot on the bank and one in the river saving us. And I bring it back to salvation because that's what this is about. That's what this theology is about. It is about the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Because I mentioned throughout the course that the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ is our protection against this speculation going off the rails and our spirituality going off the rails. And the Orthodox position is really interested in maintaining the tension, maintaining the mystery, maintaining the scandal of the incarnation, maintaining the we never would have expected it this way, aha, of Jesus dying and rising. And we're also uncomfortable with it on a personal level. I know I am. The cross of Jesus can be a bitter pill. And the sword that Jesus says that he has brought, not peace, but the sword is not directed against neighbor, it's directed against ourselves, against our pride, against our puffed up sense of ourself and our own importance, of our egotism, of if our problem is an addiction, we have to take the sword to that. And that cross is something we naturally shrink against. We would never expect to worship a God who suffers. There's a poem that I always enjoy thinking about that brings this home to me in our spiritual life because naturally I shrink from the cross. I slipped his fingers. I escaped his feet. I ran and hid for him I feared to meet. One day I passed him fettered on a tree. He turned his head and looked and beckoned me. Neither by speed nor strength could he prevail. Each hand and foot was pinioned by a nail. He could not run, nor clasp me if he tried. But with his eyes, he bid me to reach his side. For pity's sake, thought I will set you free. Nay, said he, take this cross and follow me. This yoke is easy, this burden light, not hard nor grievous if you wear it tight. And so did I follow him who could not move, an uncaught captive in the hands of love. Thanks, everybody, for coming tonight.
Yeah.